So we can't, yeah, we can't take them to the Old Country Buffet.
Yeah, okay, we'll find another place.
Good evening, and welcome to Inside Your District. My name is Marcia Goodman-Hinnershitz, and I'm Councilwoman for District 2, a city of Reading. Tonight, we're going to be talking about the Reading-Reutlingen Friendship Team, and I have as my guest former Mayor Thomas McMahon, who is the coordinator of the team. Good evening, Tom.
Hi, Marcia. Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, so we want to talk about, and a lot of people aren't familiar with our sister city, Reutlingen, Germany, and how that all has evolved. So we want to talk a little bit about the history of it, and then we have some exciting events coming up the first week of July. So, Tom, can you tell us a little bit about how Reutlingen became the sister city of Reading?
Sure. It actually dates back into the early 90s when, and there's a connection with Friedrich List. Friedrich List, who was the one of the noted economists, German economists, and he was rated probably number three among the three, Adam Smith and Friedrich List and Karl Marx. But he was born in the city of Reutlingen, and there's a great story between Reutlingen and Reading and what happened in between time and how he got here and how he got pushed out of Germany and became involved with us here. But the Germans made a call to find out some information from the History Center, and they happened to talk to Paula Flippen, mm-hmm. and asked her if she knew something about Friedrich List. And of course we did, and we knew about List Road, and we knew about the connection between the Adler and Reading Eagle. And there were subsequent visits between here and Germany and vice versa. And I think we had a chorus go over, and we had people go over and serve Thanksgiving dinner one time, and eventually it led to a very strong relationship. So that's how it got started, and the Germans have been a wonderful partner ever since. This is more than 20, almost 30 years now coming up to.
Okay, so what's happened during that time, there's been regular exchanges where people go to visit the city of Reutlingen, which is in south central Germany, am I correct?
Yeah, correct, near Stuttgart, and just not too far from the Swiss border.
Right.
Yep.
Okay, so, and indeed, several years ago, a band from Reading, the Mountain Folk Band, went along, and you weren't part of that trip, were you?
Yes, I was.
Oh, you were. Okay, can you tell us a little bit about it? Because I'm going to be looking forward to a similar trip.
Oh, you're gonna go in October, and I understand. Schoenberger.
Yeah.
And it was marvelous. We went over Dave Klein, the Mountain Folk Band. Dave Klein, who's of course with WEEU as well as the Reading Eagle newspaper, and he took his band over. There's a total of five members, and they had their wives accompany them, mm-hmm. and they played. I think. Five or six gigs in Germany, and the Germans absolutely loved it. And they loved it, especially when Dave teaches them how to yodel, because yeah. they know how to yodel right near the border. But they were very well received, and we talked more about having an interrelationship where we could have a German band come over. So that's how this year we're having the 11-member Honer group coming over. Mm-hmm. It's a, as I say, 11-member harmonica accordion band, and they're going to be at the festival, and they're also going to be at a special performance at Liederkranz, which we'll talk about too.
Well, yes, yeah, and let's maybe we have the flyer for that, if we could put mm-hmm. that up on the screen, yeah. and we can talk about the Horner band. And I did a little research on the band, and basically Horner is a type of accordion, am
yes,
I correct?
That is correct.
Okay, so that we have an 11-piece accordion band. And when you look at that, how do you think that benefits the city? If someone would be able to say, to have a band and dignitaries come over from our sister city?
Well, I think in terms of relationship between the cities, it benefits it, I think, in the biggest way because of the exchanges we have between individuals that get mm-hmm. to know one another. And over the years, we've had probably 250 pairs of students, and I figure a pair is like one student from Germany, one from Reading. But 250 have spent time in each other's homes and cities, and they enjoyed and learned to appreciate the culture and some of the language and some of the history. Mm-hmm. And the same thing with the musical interchange and with mm-hmm. the cultural interchange. So we have so much of that's happening. It really enriches lives, I think, and that's what the Germans really like to do.
Yeah, and I think, again, it offers up other opportunities for other cultural exchanges that we learn about each other's history. And I think it's really interesting, the part about Friedrich List. I never knew until you shared, and I would ask our home viewers, who knows where List Road is? I think it's...
Does everybody know?
I'm not sure everyone does, but if you want to take a journey up off of Skyline Drive and just drive through the Mount Penn Preserve, you'll be able to find List Road. So I just challenge anyone who hasn't been up there to be able to do that. However, be careful not to drive up there this coming weekend, because in District 2, we're going to have the Duray Hill Climb. Okay, so a Duray Drive will be blocked off, but if you're a racing aficionado, come up and watch the cars race up Duray Drive. That's a little aside. So we have a lot of activities coming up. Starting the week of July the 4th, we have the Horner Band playing up at the Kutztown Folk Festival for 2 days. And at the same time, there's dignitaries coming in from Germany, the deputy mayor and his assistant.
Yeah, Petra Banish.
Petra Banish. And we're going to be touring them through Reading, getting them, and you can talk a little bit about what you're going to be doing mm-hmm. with that part of it. But the important part is to have the exchange and the dialogue so we can learn from their culture and they can learn a little bit about ours.
Right. Well, the home viewers really would like to put on your calendar to make sure you get up to get a chance to hear the band. You can, as Marcia said, you can hear them on July 4th or 5th up at the Folk Festival, but you can also come on the evening of Wednesday, July 6th from 7 to 9, and they're going to be performing at Liederkranz up on Spook Lane. Hill Road and Spook Lane. Instead of going off to the left for Stokes A, you make that little quick right and you're into Liederkranz Club. But you don't have to be a member to come up and join and to be in it. There's a small fee to help cover the transportation costs for the band. I think we're going to charge $7 a person. So it's a 2-hour performance. It's going to be absolutely wonderful. They have a great musical repertoire that goes from classical to actually theater music and film music and Irish music, I found out too. Mm-hmm. And so that's why we're green. And so it's going to be great fun. We want people to come up, bring the kids, and that's going to be on Wednesday, July 6th. For that.
And you have
dinner and refreshments and German beer too, by the way, up there.
Yeah, there's a lot going on up at the Liederkranz. And even though Liederkranz is actually in Lower Alsace, I consider it, it's just a little bit over the border from District 2. And mm-hmm. one of the things I'm proud about in representing the district is the beautiful mountains mm-hmm. that we have, both with Neversink Mountain and Mount Penn. What's interesting, if you look at pictures of Reutlingen, the surrounding areas, it looks very similar to Berks County. Mm-hmm. So we know that when the Germans came over, they were looking at something that felt safe and familiar to them. And so they gravitated to Berks County. Just a little bit of aside, and I'm going a little bit into my husband's family history. They immigrated to Berks County in 1752, and when we go to visit Germany this year for the first time, we're going to have an opportunity to go back very close to Reutlingen, where his family came from, and be able to find the family homestead, which was built in the 1500s. It's still there.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, and so to make that connection, and I think that's good for anyone to do, to be able to say, what were my roots, and how are they important to me, and what do I bring from my family when I come and settle in Reading? Mm-hmm. And so I always like to talk to my neighbors. We have a lot of different backgrounds to be able to say, we all blend together very well as a city. So I'm hoping that I can bring some of my neighbors up to the Liederkranz so they can see another side of Berks County's culture.
And we're so immersed. I mean, there's so much German culture here. And by the way, I'd say people who come up to the festival or be involved in the exchange program, I've gotten to know the Pennsylvania German Heritage Festival site that's right outside of Kutztown. It's actually an adjunct of Kutztown University, Patrick Dunmeyer, who is just an awesome, most amazing guy. And he has learned the Pennsylvania Dutch, Pennsylvanish or Dutch, and I'm going to kill that, and somebody's going to call me and correct me.
You have to do a really good job, but that's okay.
But he learned the dialect on his own, and he actually teaches it. And last year, he went over to Reutlingen and was part of a group that was meeting with people over in Germany that were very interested in what the how the dialect had evolved in the U.S. And Patrick was speaking to a group of them, and he's going to go back next year again and do the same. And the Germans absolutely love it. They just think it's so wonderful that we carry on that tradition here in what we call Dutch country, which is Deutsch country, which is really a Pennsylvania German heritage. And they're so strong, and I think we should be very proud of it, even though mine, I come from Ireland, so I'm proud of those too.
Yeah, and my family actually came from different areas of Lithuania and Russia, so that I don't have the German heritage. My husband's family came from Poland and from Germany, so we all have all the mixes. Mm-hmm. And I think what's important is when you go to Europe, it's a lot different than the United States as far as how people are bilingual, actually multilingual.
Oh, yes.
Okay, that they very much learn English and whatever their native language is. And I think that's something here that we need to challenge ourselves now. Mm-hmm. We have a large Spanish-speaking population that we all can be able to learn to communicate, that it's not just a one-language country now. It's going to become multilingual just like Europe is.
Sure it is. It's interesting that it's still German is being taught in some of the schools.
Right.
And my grandson, who's 12 years old, goes to a school down in Chester County, and he's starting to learn German. And so I've asked the Germans to bring over some simple books, sort of like Dr. Seuss books in German for him to learn. But I think there's great opportunity, and so we're looking forward to it. And I would welcome anybody that's watching that wants to meet some of the folks from Germany to come up again to the festival or to come over to Liederkranz. And I think they'd love to meet you. The Petra Banish, who's my counterpart on the other side, she coordinates all the English-speaking country relationships, including the U.S., just actually two of us, U.S. and England. And they also have relationships with Germany, with France, with countries in Africa, and with one of the former Russian republics. I think it's Tajikistan. But it's going to be fun. It's going to be a good week. As you say, it's going to be a busy week. Next week, we also have the 4th of July concert out at the stadium, which I think is going to be great.
Yeah, maybe we should just sort of go through the days. July 4th, of course, the Horner Group and all of us are going to be up at the Kutztown Folk Festival. But what's really special on July 4th is there's a concert, Reading Symphony, at the First Energy Stadium. And they're going to be music. They're going to be doing the classics like the 1812 Overture. Mm-hmm. Help me with some of the other songs they're going to be doing.
Well, it's going to be the Tchaikovsky's Symphony No. 4.
Okay.
And I think the 1812, and I think there'll be one more Tchaikovsky. But it's probably all Tchaikovsky evening. But the 1812 Overture, complete with the cannons, or at least the sound of cannons, or replication of that, is always fun. And there'll be some martial music, so there'll be some music of the American music, military music, that kind of thing for the celebrating.
And then ending with fireworks, of course.
Yes, ending with fireworks.
So again, we have something, and that's for you, to everyone to come over to the stadium then?
Yes, they need to get tickets. You get them at Boscov's or out at the stadium. And I think the last time we did it was 2 years ago. I don't think it was one last year. Yeah. But it's scheduled like every other year. And I think if you get out to get the tickets, make sure you get tickets, though, because you don't want to get out there and find it. You know, if they're all gone or you got to squeeze in the back or somewhere. But you get out there early to get a good seat and, enjoy the good weather that we hope we're going to have.
Right. So then... again, the next day, the 5th, is again up at the Kutztown Folk Festival. You'll be touring through the city with Petra and Mayor Hunt, right?
Yes, and that's a very interesting. We're going to really give and stop at many of the places, like places you all know, and thanks to your husband, who's going to help us drive the bus on Wednesday, to really visit some of the sites. He's going to take the band around, same time I'm taking a patron of hair around. But we'll go to the usual places, Stokesay and Pagoda, and over at the Heritage Center, and look at some covered bridges. And and I want to put a special thanks to the people from the Visitors Bureau, especially Marnice is going to help guide the tour, and she does a great job on the buses. So she's going to be along with us. And we'll have either Inga Rothermeyer or Henrietta Alban, who's a friend of mine. She'll be doing the translation, so we can help with that. But I think that's another way for them to understand some of the breadth of German influence that we have in our city, and I think you see it everywhere, is, and they'll be able to notice it and converse, so.
And when I was working with you to plan the trip, one of the things I thought was important, if it's a real cultural exchange, is to understand the culture of the city. So it was interesting, we talked about where are we going to be eating, and as much as there was a tendency, oh, we're going to take them to a buffet with German food, I thought, no, wait a minute, these folks are from Germany, they have much better German food, let's expose them to some real good Spanish cooking, some of the real good restaurants that we have in Reading. So that's what we've selected. I know working with Sofritos to have an opportunity there. But we just want the folks to enjoy the diversity because we have excellent small family restaurants all over the city of Reading, and we want them to experience some of that. And I was also told folks from Germany, because their beef products, I know for you that are vegetarians, you might not appreciate this, but their beef products aren't something that is outstanding in Germany. So they, when they come to the United States, like to be able to have some steak and such.
In fact, I know you and your husband were scouting out a steakhouse up in Kutztown that they might be able to enjoy. So I think they're looking forward to that. But yeah, I think it's great that we can celebrate this. I think we have a... I see a lot going on, as you mentioned, that this week and next, and the hill climb, by the way, that draws a lot of people for the weekend. And by the way, we might want to say a few words. We've already had some discussions previously about it, but you mentioned earlier in the program about the idea of the Mount Penn Preserve, which I think is a very interesting idea, and I think many of the folks may not have known about it. So you might want to say a few words about that.
Okay, if you start looking at the city, sometimes people just focus on the neighborhoods they live in, and they sort of forget about the fact that Reading is surrounded by beautiful mountains. Mm-hmm. And we have, fortunately, Mount Penn and Neversink, but we're focusing now, because the pagoda is sort of the icon on Mount Penn, is that whole preserve area, all the area around Duray Drive, that's both in Lower Alsace, Mount Penn, and Alsace Township.
Yeah.
Okay, and we want to work together, and I know Commissioner Barnhart has taken the lead together with Lee Olson and yourself, Tom, to be able to pull together a planning group that's going to involve all the stakeholders, meaning folks that all live in that area, the businesses and such, and see whether we can do some future planning on how we really build this into what's already turning into a tourist attraction, but not in a planned kind of way.
Exactly. And I think that, and people say, well, what could be different? Well, I say, what is different, right? What could be different in the future is right now when you look at what's happening, the Duryea Hill Climb is happening. And then there is also the bike racing that we have, and also the mountain bikes. But many people do the downhill biking. This is great. But when we think of the events that happen either at Pagoda or at the William Penn Fire Tower, and there could be a lot more up on the mountain to celebrate that. And the trails, by the way, the hiking trails, I don't know how many people have had a chance to do that, but when I lived up close to the mountain, under the base of the mountain up by Albright, I would love to walk out, many times walked on trails that go up on the mountain, and they go off in different directions, and you can really hike all over the mountain.
What I find interesting, like I live at the base of Neversink, and a lot of the children come and they play in the playground. They never venture up onto the mountain trails at all. And even though Berks Nature has done an excellent job of setting up a trail system all through Neversink, across, you know, up on Mount Penn, I don't see a lot of the younger folks, and I think it's because they're not familiar with it or they don't necessarily feel safe. So what I'd like to do is be able to say, okay, let's just take a hike up on the mountain and really get a feel of what that's about. Talk about the wildlife up there. And a lot of it comes down and visits us in our neighborhoods. If you're not good at keeping your trash can closed, you might have a raccoon or some other furry creature decide to explore.
Did deer come down also?
What's interesting, on the Neversink side that we live on, we don't have the deer because the deer are looking for water.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so they go down on the other side that goes to the Schuylkill River. Mm-hmm. And some people probably don't even realize if you climb up to the top of Neversink, you can look down the other side and see the Schuylkill.
Mm-hmm.
What does happen, though, is the Mount Penn side of the mountain, where there are a lot of springs and such, deer are all over the place, and an occasional bear, from what I understand, too. So we have a lot of wildlife that we have to respect, that's their environment, and as they populate, they tend to sort of come into the human areas, and a lot of folks that live up in Hessian Camp and stuff have problems with, you know, the deer eating their flowers and such, so we have to learn to coexist.
Yeah.
Now, what else is interesting is because the mountains become so popular, we see a lot of young people using it for different reasons. I was up last Saturday talking with the folks as they were getting ready to set up for the hill climb, and here a couple skateboarders came down Duray Drive. Okay, so then they said they're from Philadelphia, and that's one of the hills they like to come down. The problem with that is it's open for traffic, and it's not really safe to skateboard down the hill at the same time cars are coming the opposite direction.
No, but it's a good point that if you were to do that up on Skyline Drive, on the more of the vertical, there's still some really good hills. You can get up a good speed. Mm-hmm. But going up and down, well, you can go up on a skateboard, but going down Duray Drive on a skateboard, coming around those turns could be pretty dangerous.
But they're also, I'm amazed at the skill level of these young people, watching them come down, and they were doing twirls. I don't know the technical names for all these things, but I was really impressed by the skills. It was just, I was concerned about the traffic.
It's death-defying, is what it is.
But what they were saying is they'd like to have races and such, you know, or be able to have competition the same way the hill climb is a competition of timing, who gets to the top of the mountain first.
Yeah.
They would do the same thing downhill, just the same way with the bike races that come downhill.
Yeah.
Okay, so again, you see the potential here, and I'm so glad people are rediscovering the mountain, but what we need to do is do it in a planned way that it's safe. Mm-hmm. Now I want to sort of focus the last 5 minutes of the show just a little bit about what's going on in the neighborhoods. It's summertime, and summertime for me is flower time. It's the time we really can beautify our properties. And so this year, met with a group of neighbors at St. Matthew's Church at 18th and Cotton, and the folks decided they wanted to have some kind of contest, if you may, to be able to see who can make their properties, fix them up a little bit. So if you can put up the flyer, we have a little small beginning contest, if you may, called Curb Appeal. And the purpose of this is to ask people that live in a certain section of East Reading, because we couldn't do the whole East Reading at this point. We're small and starting out from 15th to 19th Street, from Cotton up to Fairview. If you would just sort of enter this contest and show how you fixed up the front of your home to give it curb appeal. Mm-hmm. And we have an example of a property on Perkiomen Avenue, if you can show us that. This is just one example, and it's hard to see, but there are rose bushes, okay? What I've noticed as I've been walking around the neighborhood, a lot of people have roses in the front of your yard. Mm-hmm. That's actually very much a European tradition to do that, which is sort of neat to see people fixing up. But what we want to do is encourage people to go on the Reading City Council Facebook. You can download the application, send it into City Hall, and what we'll do is anyone that has entered will be visiting their homes. We have a group of judges, and we want to be able to give people some recognition for being able to spruce up their properties and give a curb appeal. And I know it's a hard time of year to do it now because we're getting into the hot time of summer, but we want to see what folks have done, you know, really fix up their properties. And we're going to start small this year. We're going to encourage it to grow. So eventually, all across the city, we'll have people, instead of being focusing on the negatives, focusing on how they can beautify their properties.
Well, let me ask you, just got a minute or two left. How's the progress of Pandora Park with the construction and the new landscaping and the new Olivet Boys and Girls Club? How's that coming?
Well, the Olivet Boys and Girls Club, it looks like they're in the finishing touches now. The building's all done, blends very beautifully with the landscape at Pandora. Also, whoever did the landscaping design did an excellent job, so they planted a lot of new trees there, plus some other flowers and such. I believe the club is tentatively going to have its soft opening towards the end of August. Okay, so one of the things that surprised me, the building was a lot larger than I expected, which means the kids are going to have a great facility, and it overlooks the ball field. So we're going to see a real repurposing of that whole Pandora Park area with that clubhouse opening. And I know, did that start in your administration, Tom?
Yes, yes.
The discussions about that?
Yeah, we had the first meetings with your neighbors, and we had a lot of discussion that surrounded that. But when we realized that the kids, especially the kids at 16th and Hawk, they're going to have a place to stay and play and be safe, And they had to go to 13th, was it 13th and Perky Elman?
Yeah, and that wasn't really that great a facility.
It was terrible condition. Yeah. It was just falling down. It was it was just in bad shape and really needed it. So, you know, congratulations to the Boys and Girls Club. I think it's going to really do a lot for the neighbors and for the kids, especially in the future.
Yeah, and so if you have a chance, walk down up South 19th Street and you'll see the club. And we want everyone, and that's one of the reasons we're doing the curb appeal thing, is just to get everyone together as a community and say, what can we all do together? All of this is a great partner. Reading Recreation Commission does a fabulous job of managing our parks and our ball fields and such. Mm-hmm. We now have a lot of activity up at Eggleman's Park. The field houses, the ball fields, the pavilions can be rented out. So we're really using the best that we can do with our resources. So when I look to the future with the Mount Penn Preserve, looking at what we can do to expand the uses of the pagoda, we're just at the beginning here.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things I'm going to be really proud to show off when our folks come from Reutlingen, is what we've been able to do as a city that maybe is stressed economically. We still know how to really make things happen.
Make it look nice. So great. Sounds like fun.
Okay, so home viewers, I hope to see you out and around. My husband and I do a lot of walking through East Reading, so say hello if you see us walking by and give us your ideas of what we can do to continue to make our city grow. Thank you and good evening.